Everybody refilled, caffeinated, ready to go. All right. Next up, we have Ray Chow with Fousey. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Fousey, perfect. And they are actually a, where are they now? They presented back in 2014, I believe,
2016
with us. And they're here to tell us how far they've come, what they've been doing with their business, and how much the food truck industry has changed in the last 2 years as well. So, without further ado, here's Ray. Good morning. Thanks for having us back again. It's been a very fast 2 years. My name is Ray Chow. I'm the Chief Food Truck Officer and co-founder of Fousey. Who loves food trucks? Raise your hand. That better be everybody's hand, because this is the frontier. This is not the frontier picture, but there are pictures of, there are food trucks out here every week. So you guys should frequent our local food truck entrepreneurs. I started in the restaurant business many years ago. And had and of course, as my business has changed, I sold my brick and mortar restaurant and built a food truck. And as we've kind of built and learned, it's a growing industry, okay? And in 2012, National Restaurant Association, right where the food truck craze was somewhat beginning, estimated there was only like 4,000 food trucks in the entire nation, okay? Fousey has built a database over 59,000 food trucks. And we're tapping into this $2.7 billion market. So, how do food trucks operate? Their typical business model is DP squared, is what we call it. Drive, park, and pray. Okay. So every morning I get in my food truck, I'm loading it, I'm going to my location, where do I park, how am I gonna serve, make sure nothing's falling down, get to my location, and all right, I'm setting up, and I'm ready to go. I'm driving to my location, finding a place to park, and then when I'm ready, with my hands together, I'm praying that customers like you can find me and buy from me. So, what is Fousey and the Fousey platform in action? We have our event coordinator, Ashley, okay? She's been tasked by her VP of sales. Hey, find me a food truck. We want to feed everybody for lunch tomorrow. So Ashley's like, I don't know how to find food trucks. So she goes and mines the web. And then there's people like me. I'm the food truck owner. I'm drive, parking, praying. I'm ready to make money today, but I don't know where to go. I have to book my locations ahead of time. And then there's consumers like Charlie. He's visiting RTP today. He wants to eat at a local business. He wants to check out some of the food trucks. He has no app. He don't know how to find them. He can't buy from them. So basically, event coordinators like Ashley, food truck owners like myself, and our consumers like Charlie are just a tip of the beta platform, where Fousey is building a platform for the entire industry that touches on 9 different consumer segments. So the rise of the food truck industry has been totally disrupted. Why? Because about anybody can build a food truck business for around $50,000 or less. Do a couple $100,000 a year in business, you got some good nets, you got a great job for yourself. And that's really changed how the restaurant and food industry has grown over the years. So where are we now? This is why we're here. 2 years, I wish I knew what I know today. 2 years ago, we would have been so much farther along. And we're finally learning and pivoting. And we're finally pivoting to making money. And that's what the bottom line is. And that's why it's giant, big dollar sign. We've learned and pivoted and changed our product, changed our audience, who we're building for. But bottom line is we have to have a revenue generating product so we can consistently learn and build along the way. So currently we have over 800 users that we haven't marketed to in 23 different states. And the way we look at it is upon release of our next product that can generate revenue, we could probably start off around $39,000 a month in gross revenue with our existing customers. In addition to generating revenue, we also have some marketing services that we've provided. And as we market and expand on those, we're looking at bringing on an additional $2,500 a month. And of course, with building our consumer apps, of course, with the in-app advertisement, and premium upgrades for the general consumers. We're looking at potentially bringing another $2,000 a month in revenue. So what's coming soon? All of you guys who are wanting to find a truck, I need a consumer app. I need a consumer app that works. I need a consumer app that has data, and I need a consumer app that I can rely on. That's what's coming up. Because consumer app without data is useless. So just imagine one day, this is the FUSI vision of what we're looking at building one day. FUSI is going to be providing technology tools for the food truck owner, basically do everything for them but the cooking. We want to have basically IoT on a food truck, monitor every piece of equipment for them, give them a heads up on maintenance, what's working, what's not. We also want to help them automate with their inventory so that they don't have to do the inventory on a manual basis anymore. And consumers like to utilize the app. I want to order from a truck and go to a truck and pick my food and pay without paying through the window. These are just some of the vision and ideas, wish lists that we're looking at developing over the years so that food truck owners can do what they just love best. They just love to cook. So where are we at now? We're in the midst of raising money. Okay, we're raising up to $1 million to make all this happen. Of course, launch product, scale up our additional IP work, scale up our sales and marketing, and of course, take care of buying my coffee this morning. So we've built a huge food truck family, not only in this area, but nationwide. One of my friends, Courtney with Q-spresso, has says, FUSI is a stepping stone into the future of food trucks. I just love that quote all the time. That's what I want to share with you. But we've also had a good number of industry recognition based on the work we've done so far. So what's our next step? This is where I need your help. Okay? Yes! There you go, there. FUSI's built a survey for our consumers because data is what we're building upon. So go to FUSI.com, check out our consumer survey, help us get more data. And of course, every time we present, we're looking for investors. People want to write a check. I'm very proud to say that we've built an investor portal where all the information is there for you to review so that you're 100% ready to write that check. And finally, food truck owners. We've built the beta app for the food truck owners to run and check in at their locations. Anyone you know who's not using FUSI app, say, hey, you guys, you gotta use the app so I know how to find you. My name is Ray Chow, Chief Food Truck Officer. That's how you can find me, and I'm open for questions. Thank you. That's right.
Thank you, that was very interesting. A couple of questions. First of all, do you have a way that somebody could go to your website and give you their location, and then you would show them where all the local food trucks around them might be, where they could go out for lunch that day, et cetera? Does anybody do that, or do you do that?
Currently, you're looking at the perspective of a general consumer.
Yes.
The way I envision, most consumers are probably using their mobile devices. However, that information can be easily available on a web portal just as well. Our majority of our event coordinators who are looking at hiring trucks, a lot of times they may be more predominantly in a office setting. So we will have a web portal more designed for the event coordinators. However, for any consumer group, we always will have a mobile platform and a web portal as well.
And one other quick question. 20 years ago, I used to teach entrepreneurship at Duke's Business School, and at that time, 4 out of every 5 new businesses, I don't want to depress anybody here, but 4 out of every 5 new businesses failed within 5 years, but 4 out of 5 restaurants failed within 2 years. How long do food trucks stay in business?
That's a great question.
That's a great question. Now, you also got to think. The rise of food trucks has started, what, good 6-7 years ago. Okay, is it declining? Negative. There's new trucks coming to the market every day. Okay, think about the cost to start a restaurant. That cost just keeps rising further and further. You're in a brick and mortar location. okay? The consumer demands are higher. Starting a food truck, you know what? I'm 10 to 25% the cost of a restaurant to start a food truck. If it doesn't work in one location, start key, and I go somewhere else. If I'm in a brick and mortar restaurant, it doesn't work. Guess what? I signed a 5-year lease. I've got a long uphill battle ahead of me.
It's so, also just as easy to close down.
Absolutely.
Easier to close down
a food truck. And then if it's only $50,000 into a food truck and you just gave it away, you lost $50,000. But chances are you can sell it. Okay? If you built a restaurant for $500,000 and you try to sell it and you get 10 cents on the dollar, you got $50,000 back, but you lost $450,000. Does that make sense? So if that comparison, I could start 9 food trucks and bell them all up, and I'm still even with one brick and mortar restaurant.
Next. Right over here. Hey, 2 quick questions. One, I see you're trying to reach food truck owners out there. Are you making it easy for them to refer their friends and other people they're working with?
Absolutely. The key to our growth is definitely start off with a communication platform. The culture that I'm building in this area, we're a food truck family. We're here to kind of help each other out. So when one product is great and it works, one service is great and it works, or they meet a vendor that has great services and prices, we all share. So thus, as we launch and as we listen to the features that they're looking for, and as we release new versions, word of mouth is gonna be one strategy. And a lot of times that takes a lot better credibility here from a fellow food truck owner of something that I've used that works, in addition to push marketing strategies that we'll be launching out.
Cool. And then do you have any way for food truck owners to see there's 10,000 people here and no food trucks near them, and it's kind of a sudden event that's maybe not an organized thing, but hey, there's a sudden surge of people. Anything like that?
Haven't thought about it in reverse that way. Typically, it's more of people are looking for trucks at their particular events. If you say there's a sudden surge, it could contribute to, you could be in Manhattan and there's 1 million people within a few blocks just because of all the high rises. Okay. But, you know, do a plug-in into government data that gives you population densities in certain areas. That could be one factor to say, hey, this may be a good spot for a daily food truck spot because there's a high density of population in there. Or we could park in RTP on Monday through Fridays at the Frontier because there's 1,000 people in this building working every day for lunch. So definitely things for down the future for consideration.
We got one here, then we're going over here, then back over here.
Yes, sir.
I have about 15 things to talk to you about, which I'm not gonna do right now.
We'll pick the top 2.
Everybody will get really upset.
We'll pick the top 2.
Can you explain your methodology in terms of how you're helping the food trucks with the logistics of resupplying? You know, because I think one of the biggest challenges they have is they don't really understand demand. How much stuff do they bring with them? Who's going to run back to the canteen when they need, you know, 9 new heads of lettuce? Or how can it get to them in some way in a real-time methodology, especially if you have, you know, at a particular place, you have 10 food trucks and they can all get supplied by through the same portal. You know, it would seem logical to me that, you know, you're matching supply and demand and you're being the clearinghouse for all that, and that's a wonderful place to be. So if you can explain that, that would be helpful. And the second thing that I'll say is, and I'm gonna help you here, I'm in for 20,000. So anybody else here who wants a match, let's do it, because this is definitely something that I think is a phenomenal way to organize a disorganized business. And you know, there's no insight on the runway in terms of people, the popularity of this. So,
all right, let me address your question. I'm going to summarize it in a great analogy: proactive versus reactive. Okay, when a food truck runs out of food, it's no badge of honor, okay? And then you're missing opportunity on sales. Is that correct?
Oh yeah.
So now you've got high stress, panic, rush, drive 100 miles down the road to Restaurant Depot, get food as quick as possible, get back to the truck, prep it really quick, and hopefully it get back to the truck in time for you guys to still buy lunch before 1 o'clock, okay? That's a lot of work. That's being reactionary, being proactively is, what's the reputation data for this particular event in the past? Is it a first annual event or is it a 50th annual event? How many attendees do they usually have? What's the right ratio for the number of guests to food trucks to hire? That's the data that has to be provided, that's given to the food truck, so they know how much to bring upon arrival. Okay, they know they're gonna come out here, RTP on Fridays for lunch at the Frontier. There's what, 4 or 5 trucks out here? They're gonna serve 80 to 125 guests per truck. I know that, because I was one of the trucks that's been doing it. But that's the data that they have to have so they can have a successful event. Like I said, running out of food is no badge of honor. You're giving up opportunity. So if you can be having that information and armed with it on your app, on your phone, on your tablet, when the truck goes out to serve an event, I already know about what I'm gonna sell today, just based on historical data and reputation for various events. Does that answer? Okay. And we'll take you up on that 20,000.
It's not just me, it's everyone else.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, yes, ma'am.
I have a question. There is, maybe you're not aware about that, you know what I'm saying, about these food trucks these days. It has become like a mafia, you know what I'm saying? I have friends who own about 40 food trucks. When you want to go park, like, let me ask you a question. Are your people, what you have, those truck drivers, because you have the location, you know the location, are you going to be charging them?
We're not a 501c3 organization.
No, not talking about I'm talking about going to a parking lot, wherever that event.
Yes.
Because it has become like, you know, those food trucks, when they go park, they pay a certain fee. Are you going to be charging them, or are you just showing them where the truck
is? It is going to be that's a very general question, because there's a lot of locations that are free to park and serve.
But 95% now you have to pay, sir.
There are locations where, absolutely, the event coordinator or the property manager or the property owner says, hey, I'm gonna charge you for you to serve here. And that is all the information that food truck owners need to have before they go to their event and say, I am gonna serve at the Frontier on a Friday for lunch because there's no fee, okay? However, now there's $50 fee for me to serve. I'm fine, I'll go serve. But that's the information that they have to have before booking the event, and definitely before showing up for the event.
Because most of them now, you know what I'm saying, there is a company which does that, you know what I'm saying, very popular company, it has become like a franchise, where every food truck, it has to pay in a certain, maybe you might not be aware of it, but most of 95% of these food trucks are paying for these places, and there is a company which does that, and negotiate with the property owner, whatever event is, and you have to pay for that. Are you aware of that?
Absolutely. And here's the reason why. Okay, there are free events and there are locations that you have to pay. Every food truck owner is an independent, local, operating entrepreneur that they make their own decisions. If I'm happy to pay $200 to serve lunch, I will be there. And there's a lot of trucks that will say, you know, I'm not gonna pay that, okay? Sure, there are gonna be companies that want to come in and say, I'm gonna start managing all these locations. Wonderful, go for it. There's plenty of locations that still offer free parking for the trucks to serve. There's a lot of churches, there's a high demand with school events. Okay, there's tons and tons of festivals, organizations, of course they're gonna charge. Who's gonna pay for the porta-johns and the rent-a-cops and the permits and all the insurance, okay, and all the barricades, all the marketing? Of course they have to charge trucks. But for a company to come in and try to implement a program and start making money where trucks are already serving for free, they've got an uphill battle for them.
Right here?
Yes, sir.
Right here, right.
Yes.
So first of all, thanks for coming back and giving us a 2-year update. It's always good to see those stories. Two quick questions. One is, in this very forum, we've had other presenters share their idea for the app for the food truck industry. My question is, how are you different? Second, and pick any competitor and describe that answer. Second question is, you started your presentation with, if I only knew now what I knew 2 years ago, I'd be interested in what one of those learnings would be for the group.
All right. I'm going to answer the second question first because that's what's fresh in my mind.
Okay.
We spent a lot of time learning, pivoting, and we were just like anybody else. We're afraid to charge. I'm afraid to say, pay me for this app because it's not sexy. It's not great. It's not perfect. It's not reliable. It's buggy. It didn't quite work. So we didn't put a huge value on the services that we were providing. Okay? The product that we released to the food truck was, here, hit one button, it automatically sends your location and a message that's already preset to your Twitter and Facebook accounts, to all your followers and fans, and it all happens within 1.5 seconds. Because that's how long it takes to hit one button. We didn't put a value on that. So we didn't build a revenue piece. Okay? And last time I checked, I can't pay my light bill with food truck users. I pay it with dollars. That's why that, what was it, seventh slide? Big green dollar sign. Huge piece that I learned. I wish I knew that 2 years ago. We'd be in our fourth version and everybody's paying. You guys be paying for me to present up here. If there's a revenue. And I apologize, I got so excited about, thank you. I got so excited about the second half. What was the first question? I apologize.
So how are you different from the others out there?
Oh, thank you. How are we different from all the 183 other food truck apps that's out there? Guess what? We're not first to market, are we? No. Okay. The key is data. The key is you have to serve everyone in the industry. The other food truck apps out there, they just want to build a consumer app. Charge you guys 99 cents. And we'll sell a million downloads and we'll make money. That's great. But if I open a consumer app, there's no food trucks on there. There's no data. Okay? We didn't realize what we built, but we did a lot of manual invites to food trucks to their own event, showed them years of love in this area. And all that hard work has paid off because when we launched this consumer app, that is the data that we get started. As soon as the consumer opens that app for the first time, bam! There's 70 trucks on there that are scheduled to do lunch today. Which one would you like to go to? Okay, so the key, main thing is, you have to have data. If there's no data as a user, I'm not interested. The other thing that makes us different, of course, we're gonna have an app for the consumer. You're gonna have an app and a web portal for event coordinators to hire a truck. Okay, and of course, food truck owners, I want push notification when new events come up that my calendar is available and I like to apply. So I like to do one button to apply, one button to pay, one button to go ahead and send messages out to all my social media. But that's just our beta group. We've got advertisers, we've got vendors and suppliers, government agencies. Do you know how big of a problem it is for health department inspectors to inspect a mobile restaurant? Okay, they're chasing mice. Okay, I can't inspect a food truck that on their calendar says they're over at 800 Park Offices Drive, but for whatever reason they decide to serve at 79 TW Alexander today. So health department is driving around everywhere trying to chase after trucks. So how awesome would it be that I can provide an app for the Wake County Health Department for them to see all the trucks that are checked in, ties into the county site with all their inspections, and color code the trucks based on these are the ones that are due for inspections today, these are 45 days out, these are 90, and then I can be more efficient with my time, and I'm gonna hit Southwest Raleigh, hit the four trucks that are due for inspections. So government agencies, okay? What about the IRS? Okay? Of course, it's not all cash anymore, and every food truck owner pays their sales tax on time, of course. But some accidentally or intentionally forget. How awesome would it be to pay my sales tax after one lunch? What's the time value of money to the IRS on a nationwide basis for 100,000 food trucks who pay their sales tax right after an event? Do that math. What does that worth to them? Okay, this is a service to the food truck owners to say, I'm not good with paying my sales tax, but I know I can pay it right after event. it's out of my account. I don't have to worry about it. That's just another example. Okay?
Thank you.
We're right at 10. We're going to have two questions left, and then we're going to call it, okay?
All right.
Ray, I'm Tom Eldridge. I'm in the commercial real estate business, so this is a little bit on the supply side.
Yes, sir.
How much, I have investors that are interested in the food truck business, but what is, and I don't know anything about it, so what is the demand for commissary, canteen type space or buildings that these guys are interested in doing for food trucks? Where do they go in general, and how do they get supplied?
All right. Before you answer that, let him know that you're a commissary owner as well.
Well, I was going to leave then.
All right.
Okay, great.
Wake County requires all mobile food units to have a commercial, quote unquote, commissary that they go to on a daily basis, prep, store, clean, wash, everything that they need to do to replenish their food truck. Okay? Yes, as Chris mentioned, I own a commissary as well. Okay? There are demands for a reputable commercial commissary for a lot of trucks to go visit. Now, some counties don't require it. Some states don't require it. I know parts of Virginia says you can do everything in your truck as far as I'm concerned. So the demand kind of varies by location. So let's just talk about this area first. What's the upfront monetary investment to build out location? You're basically building out a commercial kitchen.
Correct.
Right? So you're gonna be basically kind of building a restaurant to have a commercial kitchen. So high dollar equipment, a lot of finishes. Doesn't have to be prime real estate, it can be industrial park, but it still needs to have, be approved and inspected and so forth. I'm seeing the successes for investors and developers not only do a commissary, but do a kind of mixed service type facility where it could be commissary in the back, brewery in the front. If you've got enough land, it could be an entertainment venue. So you've got multiple streams of avenue to get your ROI on your investment. What's the typical food truck owner? Can't afford it. Okay. So for me, I was actually lucky enough, savvy enough, and I truly believe things happen for a reason. I found what used to be a former fast food restaurant that was 1,700 square foot, all kitchen. I closed my last brick and mortar restaurant, took all my equipment out there, and would you believe it, everything fit in that kitchen like a glove. I kid you not. I turned around the space in less than 30 days, permitted, up and running, with no demo. And I'm still there today. Now, the original goal, it was just gonna be me, myself, and my employees. But based on the culture that I've built and how I treat others, one food truck person needed a commissary, so I invited her in. She's been there 3.5 years. Now I've got 8 trucks in there. My commissary business is kind of built on its own. So yes, there is a need. The financial piece of it is the major barrier. Now as far as ROI, it all depends on what's that level of service, how many trucks are willing to pay that dollar amount, and can you get enough return on it with your investment? Yes, sir. Thank you.
Last question, right over here.
Yes, sir.
I got the easiest question.
Yes, sir.
I'm with one of the angel groups in town. I'm FRTP.
Yes, sir.
We've watched you for these 2 years, as Mr. Wellington knows. Your story is better, but I'm still confused a little bit about where you're actually at. You appear to be about $500,000 in revenue. Good deal. You're asking for an amount of money that's tantamount to a pretty serious A round, which is usually done when you're ready to expand rapidly.
Yes.
But yet that I saw a long list of development things you gotta do because you aren't ready yet. That's my interpretation of it.
Okay.
So get me comfortable with how you're gonna use about $1 million if that investment occurred.
Well, Chris and I both have our eye on this 2018 Ferrari 488 GTB. He gets the red one, I get the black one.
If I get a green one, that'll be fine.
We're learning and pivoting along the way. These are numbers that we have been using, and
I'm on use of funds. What are you going to use the money for?
Use of funds, product development. That's one of the key things, because we have to send out the products out there to start generating revenue. We're past the point of building free products, because if we're not generating revenue, we can't get the return. But like I said, what mentioned in the second to the last slide, we also have to cover our operational overhead and expenses, okay? We'd love to be in it 1,000% moving forward so that we can be sustainable and be able to continue and scale and further develop. As I mentioned before, 9 different customer segments. We need to build products, and they need to be coming out rapidly after each succession of releases. So, and at the same time, IP work. We got a good jump start on our IP with what we built, but it's incomplete. And we're still, and of course, sales and marketing. You build the products, you have to tell the world about it. And you have to be able to monitor and keep reaching out to your potential customers and start scaling up the growth.
Perfect. All right, thank you very much, Ray.
Thank you.
Real quick, Ray, we already, there in the back, you get a mug as well.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Perfect. And then I did promise that we were going to give away a mug to someone who checked in online. Thank you for the 35 of you who did that, of the 72 we had today come in, which is awesome. So, James Lakeland, are you here?